Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up, after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. He presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, "You heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It's not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority." I want to key in on this verse, verse 8. "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." Amen. So Jesus says right here, when we get the Holy Spirit, we receive power. You know, all of us are attacked constantly by the enemy. Mm-hmm. And there's some that are going through attacks right now, me being one of them. Others that have gone through, others that will go through. My issue is that I don't feel like doing anything, just being lazy. So I have to deal with that. Because there's some things that I was supposed to do this weekend based on my OCD schedule that I have, because I like to stick to a certain routine, that I didn't do because I didn't feel like it. So I was like, I'll just do it later. But as I was asking God to give me words to speak over the week, and I was meditating on, he put some things in my heart, and I want to talk about them again, because I think, as I said here on Wednesday, we all have to hear this over and over. Yes. So 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 through 10 from the Amplified Bible. "Therefore, humble yourselves, demote, lower yourselves in your own estimation under the mighty hand of God, that in due time he may exalt you, casting the whole of your care, all your anxieties, all your worries, all your concerns, once and for all, on him. For he cares for you affectionately and cares about you watchfully. Be well balanced, temperate, sober of mind, be vigilant and cautious at all times. For that enemy of yours, the devil, roams around like a lion roaring in fierce hunger, seeking someone to seize upon and devour. Withstand him, be firm in faith against his onset, rooted, established, strong, immovable, and determined, knowing that the same identical sufferings are appointed for brotherhood, the whole body of Christians, throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who imparts all blessing and favor, who has called you to his own eternal glory in Christ Jesus, will himself complete and make you what you ought to be, establish and ground you securely, and strengthen and settle you." Mm-hmm. So we're constantly under attack. When you have a need, what do? You usually go to someone. "You pray for me," which we do. James chapter 5, verse 16 speaks about this. "Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working." I referenced this scripture before when I opened service a few months back. And one thing that I feel that was revealed to me by the Holy Spirit about this particular verse, it's not so much that if someone prays for you, they have this wonderful authority, because we all do. But to me, what this means is that when you do that for someone that asks you to pray for them, that means that you're in agreement to what God said he's going to do for that person.
Right.
And now it's not just one person agreeing to the word of God, now there's two.
Right.
So when you ask three people, four people, there's more people in agreement with that word.
Amen.
So I was meditating on this week, and this is what I feel was revealed to me. We need not only to confess our sins or pray for one another, to come in unity of the Spirit, which is what I just said. But we also need to share with one another what God has done for us.
Yes.
We do this so that not only we overcome by the word of our testimony, but so that others can be reminded of what the Lord can do for them, and what we and that we can all use that testimony as reassurance that our faith in Jesus Christ is not in vain.
Right.
So I keep asking the Lord for more clarification on this, and he gave me this scripture, Hebrews 10, verses 35, 36. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward, for you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. It is really hard to do this, because unfortunately, our spirits live in this borrowed vessel. And this vessel and our spirit are constantly clashing.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
This body is trying to tell our spirit that he's right, but we know that that's not true.
Amen.
So then what do we do? Well, Hebrews 10, verses 23 to 25. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. When someone is going through something, it's really hard to go through it on its own. So that's why the Bible says, let's continue to come together. Because
mm-hmm.
when we do, we encourage each other. As it says here in verse 24, stir up one another to love and good works. You know?
Amen.
I saw something on Facebook. It might have been yesterday. It said, you never know how powerful a kind word is to someone else.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So that's what we do when we follow this scripture. So we know that based on this word, we know what we have to do. So then Joshua chapter 1 verse 9 says, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever we go.
Amen.
I talked about something related to this not too long ago, in which I was speaking that in, I think it's in Corinthians, it says, because the Lord is with us wherever we walk, we release his fragrance.
Amen.
And to some it's the smell of life, and to others it's of death.
Mm-hmm.
So that is confirmation that we have the Holy Spirit in us. I think Dean was talking about that not too long ago. He was having some issues where he's living. And I was actually going to tell you that when you said that, it reminded me of that scripture, you know, because you have God with you. To some people, that is like they're smelling pure death.
Mm-hmm.
So then Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5. Every word of God proves true. So as I was thinking about this and trying to see what the Holy Spirit wanted to reveal to me, I started thinking, well, who do we believe? Well, we believe the Lord. We believe his word.
Mm-hmm.
And if we believe his word, we know everything is okay.
Amen.
So that brought me to 2 Kings chapter 4, verses 25 and 26. This is the story of the Shunammite woman. It says, so she set out and came to the man of God at Mount Carmel. When the man of God saw her coming, he said to Gehazi, his servant, look, there is the Shunammite. Run over at once to meet her and say to her, is all well with you? Is all well with your husband? Is all well with the child? And as I thought about this, you know, I started thinking that we're going to face many situations in our lives. And in those situations, we're going to be asked many questions. Some of those questions are going to be these same questions that have been asked to this woman in this scripture. Verse 26 again, runner wants to meet her and say to her, it's all well with you. It's all well with your husband. It's all well with the child. And this is what she says. All is well.
Right.
It wasn't well because the child was dead. But she knew in the spirit that because of God's promise,
right,
everything was well.
That's right. Amen.
We speak the word of God, not only to ourselves or to our lives, but to others as well.
Amen.
We speak the word of God to our circumstances. Why? Because we need our words to go before us. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17. Take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. We've talked about this before. Pastor was talking about this not too long ago. We grab that sword, we have to swing it. Because if you don't move it and you don't use it, it's not going to do anything. In order for us to wield that sword, which is the word of God, we need to let it produce results in us. We need to let it nourish us. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. And he humbled you and led you hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. This is the same thing that Jesus said in Matthew chapter 4, verse 4. And who did he say that to? The devil himself.
Mm-hmm.
The devil has already been warned of the power of God's word, which is the same power that we have because we have the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
As it is in Acts chapter 1. But even though he knows about this, he still continues to try and make us believe that the word of God is faulty, that it is powerless, and that it is a lie. And he's been doing so since the beginning of time. Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, did God actually say, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden? We need to be very careful before we open our mouths, because the devil will try to use our own words against us,
yes,
by twisting around God's word.
Yeah.
There's a popular saying that goes, you have two ears and one mouth, and you should use them in that proportion. Some people might laugh. Some people might think it's funny. But what they don't realize is that they are quoting scripture.
Yeah.
And this is what it says in James 1, verse 19. Know this, my beloved brothers, that every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. We are soldiers. We put the whole armor of God. We are trained. And our training is the revelation that we receive through the Holy Spirit when our minds are renewed, when we hear the word of God. So we should continue to eat that word. We should let it be nourishment for our spirits so that we are ready to destroy the attacks of the devil, not only on ourselves, but helping others as well. Ezekiel chapter 3, verses 1-4. And he said to me, son of man, eat whatever you find here, eat this scroll and go speak to the house of Israel. So I opened my mouth, and he gave me the scroll to eat. And he said to me, son of man, feed your belly with the scroll that I give you and fill your stomach with it. Then I ate it, and it was in my mouth as sweet as honey. And he said to me, son of man, go to the house of Israel and speak with my words to them. This is our instruction. That is our action. So we should take that sword, which is the word of God, and go do what we've been instructed to do.
Amen.
Yes, Pastor.
I just made me think while you were saying that. In Revelation it says Jesus, out of his mouth comes a two-edged sword, which destroys the enemies. Well, in the New Testament earlier it said that the words that he speaks are spirit and life. That's what destroys the enemy. Our words, our tongue is just like Jesus. We're born again.
Yeah.
We have the power to use that word as a weapon.
Yes.
And that's what you're saying. We're, you know, the problem is we say things that we don't.
see that, and that's what she was facing.
Yeah.
She's 81 years old, and if they had to do surgery, they didn't know if she'd make it through being that age. But she said, praise the Lord. The doctors were mystified, and we knew it was God, because everything was shrinking.
Yeah.
They called her back in her office, so we praise the Lord. And then
yes.
The daughter that came and visited me yesterday, she told me too, because she had developed some cancer in her throat, and she said, Daddy, I'm cancer-free now.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. God is still good.
Yes.
Yes.
I
Revelation, Father, thank you for giving us your word. It's the word, Lord, that we carry as a sword. And we go out in this world with that sword, destroying all of the attacks of the enemy. We thank you, Father, because it is with that word that our minds are renewed to the truth that is what you have spoken to us about our lives, about our circumstances, Lord, about our future, about our inheritance as fellow heirs of Abraham of all of your promises. We thank you, Father, because you have chosen us to go out of this world and spread your word and light, a light that shines through us, Lord, because you live inside of us. You have given us your Holy Spirit, which is the Spirit that we give power from. And it is the power that we have. We can speak on your behalf. We can speak to everything as if you were speaking to us. Thank you, Lord, for everything that you do. As we were sharing our testimonies, I started thinking of a teaching series that I heard, that I listened to. And there's a part that he talks about the scripture, which I was trying to find, but I couldn't, that says, "Wherefore, holy brethren, be partakers of the heavenly calling." That's where we should start. We should call ourselves what heaven calls us, not what the devil calls us.
Amen.
You shouldn't say, oh, I'm such an idiot, or I'm a jerk, I'm stupid. No, that's what hell calls us.
Right.
We should call ourselves healed, blessed,
yes,
provided.
Yes.
We are His children,
yes,
because He said, child, you are mine.
Yes, that's right.
That's what we should call ourselves.
Amen.
That's our heavenly calling.
Yes.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes. All right.
We don't have any announcements, so let's go straight into our declaration of faith.
Yes.
Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God.
Hallelujah.
The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of the servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
John and Toby, would you mind taking the offering? And Toby, could you say the blessing, please?
Continues to do what it did in the beginning. Lord, just remind us to speak it, to declare your word once again.
Yes,
it has to do what it was set to do.
Yes.
We just stand on it, God.
Yes.
Now we just ask that you will bless this offering, bless the gift and the giver, and we'll give you all praise and glory in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
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 Amen. Praise God.
Glory.
As the worship team comes forth, two microphones up here that aren't being used.
Yet.
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 Amen. As the Lord leads, I'll just leave it at that. Sing it again, brother. Thank you.
Worship him, worship him. Worship him, worship him. Lord, worthy, 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 worthy. Like a storm cloud's been over. Shed off those clothes that hold us down, those things that hold us down. Thank you, Lord, that there's an open heaven in this place right now. And Lord, just like when there's a sun shower going out, the clouds are going, but this rain is still coming down, but your sun is shining forth. Let's dance in the rain, church. Casting off the spirit of heaviness. We will dance, Lord. You alone are worthy. You alone are worthy.
For you, we will dance for your glory, Lord. For salvation's in this place, for the name by which we're saved, Jesus, Jesus. Let your name be lifted high, as our thankful hearts now cry, Jesus. Heads, you ancient kings, be lifted high, you ancient glory. The King is coming in.
King is coming in.
The King is coming in.
We lift
up a shout to shake the sky. Lift up a cry, be glorified. The King is coming in.
The King is coming in.
For your glory, we will dance, we will dance. For your glory, we will dance. For your glory, Lord. We will lift up a shout to adore you. Every sound that we make, it is for you. We will dance for your glory, Lord. For salvation in this place, by the name of our words we are saved. Jesus, let your name be lifted high, as our thankful hearts now cry, Jesus, Jesus, lift up your head to ancient gates, be lifted high, before ancient goes, the King is coming in.
The King is coming in.
We're the people of God with a song to sing, and we're lifting our lives as an offering. We will dance for your glory, Lord. As the crosses of hope that we hold up high, as we tell the world that your love and life, we will dance for your glory, Lord. Lift up your head, you ancient gates. Lift up the God you worship, Lord. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. We lift up a shout to shake the skies. Be not the God he glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in.
He's here. He's here. Hallelujah. He is here. In his presence. Come on now. We will dance.
We will dance. We will dance for your glory. We will dance. We will dance for your glory. We will dance for your glory, Lord.
Yes.
We will lift up a shout to adore you. Every sound that we make, it is for you. We will dance for your glory, Lord.
For those children who haven't known you, Lord. For those who have been ran away, Lord. Who don't know the doubt, the dancing, and the freedom in your glory, Lord. We cry out to them right now, Lord. We cry out for our children, Lord Jesus, who don't truly know the joy of the Lord, Lord. To bring them freedom, Lord. Freedom of praise and glory and honor, Lord. We have so much to be thankful for, Lord. We have so much to be joyful for, Lord. We celebrate your presence, Lord. We celebrate the things you have done in our life, Lord. We have so much to be thankful for, Lord. And I pray, Lord, for those children, Lord. And our relatives, Lord. Even the one who Jody brought up this morning, Lord. We bind the chains from her thought pattern right now.
Yes.
That she be free from the lies of the enemy, Lord. Take it, Peter. Declare it in Jesus' name.
I cry freedom from the chains that bind our children. Freedom from the chains that bind our praise to you. Freedom from the lies of the enemy. Freedom. I cry freedom from the chains that bind our children. Freedom from the chains that bind our praise to you. Freedom from the lies of the enemy. Freedom. Freedom. Freedom.
that bind our children, freedom from the chains that bind our praise to you, freedom from the lies of the enemy, freedom. I cry freedom from the chains that bind our children, freedom from the chains that bind our praise to you, freedom from the lies of the enemy, freedom, freedom, freedom.
We declare in Jesus' name.
I want to praise a little longer than before. I want to lift my hands higher than before. I want to shout a little louder than before.
Hallelujah!
I want to shout a little louder than before.
Freedom.
I want to dance more freely than before.
I want to dance more freely than before. Freedom.
I want to love you more than before. I want to dance more freely than before. I want to dance more freely than before.
Freedom!
Freedom!
Freedom, 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 here we go. Hallelujah, Lord. Give them a shout, church. Come on now. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, Lord. I am longing for a place where I can lay my head upon your breast. I am looking for the time when you pour your oil over me, pour your oil over me. Pour over me, pour over me, your oil of perfect peace. Let's do that first verse again. I am longing for a place where I can upon your breath. I'm looking for a time where you pour. I am looking for the time where I pour. You pour. Time where you pour over me. Pour your oil over me. Pour over me. Pour over me. Your oil. I am looking for a time where I can steal away and find a place of rest, a place of peace. Lord, I am looking for a time to steal away and be with you, and be with you. Take me away, Lord. Take me away. Take me away so I can be with you. Let's take it up. Take it up. Oh, take me away. Pour over me the Lord. Take me away, take me away, so I can be with you. Someone, at least someone in this room right now, who is caught in the busyness, caught in the troubles of this world, and you just can't seem to cut loose. It's just like a machine that's grinding on you. You're crying out to the Lord. Help. Help. I'm drowning in this busyness. I'm drowning in this busyness. the cares of this world. He will meet you where you're at. He will meet you where you're at. Lord, distract the noise. Take the noise of this world, Lord, and mute it so we can hear your voice, Lord. I know you want to reveal, Lord, many things to your people, Lord. But the noise of this world is such a distraction, Lord. Even Jesus had to get away from the disciples and ministry, Lord, just to be with you, Lord. Show us, 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 Lord. We need refreshing rain, Lord. We need your touch again, Lord. Pour over us, Lord. Not to be busy, just to be busy, Lord. To find the quiet place. To find the quiet place, Lord. And be with you. In those quiet places, he will reveal strategies to help you deal with these busy places. But steal away. Steal away. The enemy has taken so much of your time. He's taken so much of your time. He's taken that time so he can't. He can keep you away from hearing the Lord so clearly. Break away, church. Break away from the noise. There is a peace. There is a peace that passes all understanding. There's a peace that passes all understanding.
Thank you. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. I hope that when you're experiencing what we experience here this morning, and I'm not just talking about emotions, but just the sense of being kind of taken into the spirit realm, to claim the healing, to claim the deliverance, to claim the breakthrough that you've prayed about, that you've asked us to pray about. I mean, those are the moments when God wants to just release us, amen, from all of the anxiety and the care and the worry, and just give it to God and say, thank you, Jesus, as though you had the answer in your hand, because you have it, amen, it's done, it's finished. We just have to claim it, and that's the perfect time to do it, amen, when our realization of God is at a height. You know, I mean, God is the same all the time. He never leaves us or forsakes us, but our awareness does fluctuate. Amen. So it's a time when God is so real to us that we can have the faith. As little as it takes, we have it to just say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for answering that prayer. Thank you, Lord, that the next week we're going to give a testimony about what you did this week. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Amen. God bless you all. May be seated. Thank you again, as always, worship team. They did a fantastic job this morning. They always do. Praise the Lord. If you were here Friday night, they did a marvelous job. Amen. They were really, the Spirit of God was really moving in the worship portion of the service, and that was exciting. Hallelujah. So God is good all the time. Amen. All right. God bless you, and young people, you can be dismissed to go downstairs. Hallelujah. They're happy and eager to go, praise the Lord. I saw a couple of the adults there kind of flinch, but I know all of you. I recognize you, praise the Lord. So if you go down, you're busted, praise the Lord. Amen. God is good. I appreciate all the testimonies. Thank you for sharing your prayer requests, giving us an opportunity to agree with you, and expect God to do wonderful things. Amen. Thank you, Roberto, for your opening. Amen. It blessed me, and it also set up my message for this morning. So that's always good. Hallelujah. And you'll get your percentage at the end of the week. Praise the Lord. It'll be small, but it'll be a percentage. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you again. And let's begin with Matthew chapter 6, verses 31 through 33, if you will, Sheila. Thank you. Praise the Lord. God is good, isn't he?
Yes, he is.
Amen. He's doing some wonderful things. Hallelujah. And it's exciting when you have an expectation of what God's going to be doing in your life. And you can expect God to do what you've been praying about. Hallelujah. If it's in agreement with his word, you have every reason to declare it done. Hallelujah. And just enjoy it. Praise the Lord. Have fun with it until you see the manifestation. Just relax. Hallelujah. Amen. Okay, therefore, take no thought saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? Now, that obviously is about those particular things, but it's also a metaphor for everything that we feel anxious about, for everything we're afraid that might not happen the way we want it to happen, right? Whether it's healing, whether it's relationships restored, whether it's finances, anything. That's all kind of encapsulated in that. Because after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all these things. But here's the kicker. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Now his righteousness translates God's way of doing things. Well, what is God's way of doing things? He speaks. Right? It was dark and he said, let there be light. And light was. Amen? So he spoke and the firmament separated from sky and water and you know, he spoke animals into existence. He spoke everything into existence. And he says that we're supposed to do this. This is what we're supposed to do. Instead of worrying about all this junk, do what God does. Seek the kingdom of God and his way of doing things, and these things will be added to you. Amen?
Amen.
Say praise the Lord. All right, let's go to Romans chapter 8, and we'll just read one scripture here, and then we'll get into this. Romans 8, verse 31. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. What shall we then say to these things? What things? The things we just talked about, all the junk, everything, anything, right? What do we say to these things? I got a banknote due. What do I say to this thing? I got this physical issue. What do I say to this thing? I got this relationship that's all messed up. What do I say to this thing? Baby needs a new pair of shoes, praise the Lord. What do I say to this thing, right? If God's for me, who can be against me? Hallelujah. That's what I say to the devil when he comes and says, oh, this thing is terminal, you know, or this is never going to work out. This is good. You know, you've been dealing with this all your life. It's never going to go away. This relationship's going to fly to pieces like all the others. This is not going to work out. That's not going to work out. The kids are going to go nuts. They're going to leave home. They're going to get into trouble. And all of this stuff. What do I say to those things? If God is for me, who's against me? Who can be against me? Amen. If God's on my side, pity the enemy. Pity the one that's against me, because he's going to have his self handed to him in a sling. Praise the Lord. God can deal with anything that I can believe him for. Praise the Lord. So we need to become experts at preaching the gospel to ourselves first and foremost. You know, he said when you ought to be teaching, you're still in need of a teacher. Well, let's move on. I think we've been taught. It's time that we start doing some teaching, that we start speaking and preaching the Word of God, and start with us. Start with yourself. Amen? Most of the unhappiness, most of the confusion, most of the doubt and anxiety and fear in life is due to the fact that we listen to ourselves instead of talking to ourselves. Praise the Lord. Amen. How many times you get caught listening to that negative that the enemy has sown into your head because of everything that we see in the natural realm and all the things that we hear and experience? It's high time that the church, those of us who are kings and priests, by the way, ought to be doing some preaching, hallelujah, and we ought to start with ourselves, amen, because we listen to ourselves instead of talking to ourselves. I'm talking to myself all the time. I notice every once in a while I'll be sitting at a stoplight and I'm just talking, and I look over and I'm the only one in the car, and then I happen to glance over and the people in the other car are looking like, I wonder if that's Bluetooth or is he just nuts, praise the Lord. So we need to talk to ourselves. We need to remind ourselves of who we are in Christ, that I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I am perfect in Him. Amen? It isn't based on what I'm doing, it's based on what He has done, hallelujah, that has given me my identity, praise the Lord. So we need to start talking to ourselves instead of listening to ourselves. A defeated, depressed, anxious, exhausted, joyless, burnt out Christianity is not Christianity. It's something else, but you can't define it as Christianity. Amen? We need to lay hold of the cross and remember our new life in Christ. We are new creatures in Christ. We're not what we are. We're not subject to the things we were subject to before. Hallelujah. We need to preach the gospel to ourselves. Amen. The main thing about spirituality, and I think we forget this, is that we need to know how to handle ourself. Because ourself is our flesh. That thing we look in the mirror, it isn't just this, but it's my way of thinking. It's my way of doing things. Rather than do it the way God does it, I try to get what God has for me by doing it my way. And I'm sorry, I'm not Frank Sinatra. And you're not going to do it your way, amen. You're either going to do it God's way or it's not going to get done. Amen. So we need to start recognizing, amen, that spiritually, we like to think of spirituality being, you know, wow, we're casting out demons, we're healing the sick, we're raising the dead. Of course, that's all a reality. But you'll never do that if you don't ever deal with self. If you don't get the victory over your own flesh, and I'm not talking about going out and doing bad stuff, I'm talking about thinking. The way we operate has to be the way God. You can't, look, the kingdom goes where we go, but the kingdom doesn't expand unless somebody's doing the way God does. Right? I mean, we could come into a situation or a circumstance, and for the moment, because we're in Christ, we are kind of insulated from that. But if we want to change the surroundings, now, okay, I'm protected, so, hey, what the heck, let it all go to hell, right? No, I mean, I'm okay, so it's your problem. No, if I want the environment to change, if I want the circumstances to change, then I got to do it the way God does it. right? Seek the kingdom and his way of doing things. I've got to figure out what's his way of doing things and then do it that way. After all, we are the body of Christ. Doesn't it seem kind of schizophrenic that the body of Christ would function differently than Christ?
Yeah. Right.
That we would try to do it in a human way when Jesus always did it by the words that came out of his mouth? The words that I speak, they're spirit and life. They'll change situations. Yeah. They'll bring life where there's death. They'll bring spirituality where there's carnality.
Yeah.
Amen? So we need to realize ourself, our flesh, our way of doing things is one of our biggest issues.
Right.
Amen? Take yourself under control. The scripture talks about it. We have always thought, because 90% of what we hear preached in church is about how bad our behavior is, you know? It's about a act or a thing that we've done or said or whatever. That's not what this is about. That's not what he's talking about. We need to take ourself, our way of thinking and our way of doing things under control. Amen? We need to suppress that way of doing things. We need to talk to ourselves. We need to preach to ourselves. We need to question ourselves. Where'd that thought come from? You know, why am I feeling this way? Why am I afraid? Why am I anxious? Why am I, freaking out about the situation or that? So why? Amen? 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 4 and 5. Listen, if you just take a little bit of what I'm talking to you about this morning, your life will be changed. And not only will your life be changed, it will change the lives of the people that you come into contact with. Come on, we've got the Spirit of God. We have the Godhead, the fullness of the Godhead dwelling in us, and we're still fumbling and bumbling around as humans. Praise the Lord. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Okay, what are the weapons of our warfare? They're not natural ways of doing things. That they're mighty through God, and they, because we do it God's way, they break down the strongholds, the positions that the enemy has tried to establish in our lives and in our way of doing things, right? So we cast down imaginations. That's those thoughts that are not agreeing with God's thoughts. Amen? And every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. And by the way, not your obedience, but his obedience. Amen? Bring every thought into the obedience of Christ, which means let every thought that you have be based on the finished work of the cross. So when a thought comes and says, oh man, it's cancer. Or, oh buddy, debt, income, ain't going to happen. You know, oh man, as Tim was talking about, relationships that are strained over time for who knows why. It happens. You can't have a relationship without some issues, right? I mean, that's what relationships are about, compromise and all that all the time. So how about we think, amen, that God's going to restore every one of our relationships? I talked about this a couple of weeks ago or a couple of months ago or so, and I've had some dysfunction. Of course, my older brother always says, if you have a family, you have dysfunction. There's no such thing as non-dysfunctional families because they're filled with dysfunctional people, praise the Lord. Amen, but my past was one of a lot of relationships, and if you could call them that, but experiences, amen, that caused a lot of pain for myself, for other people, even for children, married, divorced, you know, broken relationships, all those kinds of things. So I have a daughter that lives in New Jersey, and I hadn't seen her for probably, 5-6 years or something. We were in contact, but just, limited. And I have a son that did live in St. Louis. He now lives down around the Lake of the Ozarks. But he and I never had much of any kind of a relationship. I mean, I went to his graduation. He went to a military academy. He came to my place a few times. And we, very limited and not comfortable. You know what I mean? You know what I'm saying? It's like if you're around family, you're around them all the time, you can be comfortable, you're just yourself. But when you don't have that ongoing relationship, you want to be yourself, but at the same time, you want them to like you.
Yeah.
And for me, that can be a problem sometimes. I can't just be myself and be liked, so I got to figure out what is it they like, and then I'll be that for a little while. But I can only do it for a little while, because it's a lot of work, amen, being somebody that you're not, right?
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. But here's what I want to say. God has restored those relationships. Honestly. I mean, they were, both of them were back here this past spring. Had a big family get together. All of my side of the family was there. And it was so relaxed. Just like God just did it, you know. I would have been stressed out trying to figure out how to do it and make everything right, you know, and trying to figure out, okay, what was it that offended, and, you know, what did I say or do or whatever. God just did it. I mean, just beautifully. Just like what Tim's talking about. We were down at Lake of the Ozarks because my oldest daughter her and her husband have a place down there. That's where we went on vacation. We went down and stayed at their place for a couple of weeks while they weren't there, so it was just for us. And my son lives on the other end of that lake, so we went out to eat. We went to their place for brunch. We went out to dinner. They came over to the lake. Kids, grandkids swam. It was like there had never been a problem. And we're in contact all the time, same way with my daughter. So I'm just saying, God wants to restore these things. This is the way God works. But if left to ourselves, we think they're offended, this one's offended, that one's offended, and they have a right to be because I didn't live like I should have, and I didn't do everything, and I wasn't the perfect father, and all those things. They had every justification and reason for there being alienation, right? But God knows the desires of our heart. He knows they want family. I want family. He restores it. He gets the glory.
Yes.
Amen? He knows how to fix those things that we can't fix.
Right.
He knows the inner workings of each one of us. I may think I know, and I could screw it up big time by trying to fix something that ain't broke, right?
Right.
But God knows where the real issue is, and He'll deal with it.
Yes.
We just need to trust Him. We need to declare, yes, all of my relationships are whole. Right? We need to declare that God is my source. Doesn't matter what the bank says. Doesn't matter what the job says. It doesn't matter what any of that. God is the source. And He can use any multitudes of ways, amen, to get that to you. Most of us think it's just the lottery. Oh, well, me and Roberto, but I'm saying this. When you think that, you limited God to the lottery now. And I know those odds are not that great. I'm not a great gambler. That's why I don't gamble, praise the Lord. But I know odds when I hear them. And what I hear about the lottery is really not that opportunistic for me, you know, to expect something really good is going to happen. But I can't expect that something good is going to happen if I trust the Lord. He'll provide a way. He'll make a way where there seems to be no way. Amen. He'll open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing you can't even contain. He'll do exceeding abundantly above all that you ask or think. Amen. According to His riches in glory. I'm talking about preaching to myself. I'm not just preaching to you. I spend more time preaching outside of this pulpit than I ever do in it. Amen. And 90% of it is to me. A good bit goes to my wife, but she never gives an offering. Hallelujah. So I'm guessing that she's not that impressed, praise the Lord. But we need to. I mean, we need to preach to ourselves. We need to remind ourselves of what God says about us, what God says is ours, what we can expect from God. We need to do it all the time because the devil never shuts his mouth. He never stops preaching his damnable doctrines from hell that, oh, God, you're not going to make it. You know, the kids will never grow up. They'll end up in prison. Oh, God, they're going to die. They're going to die young. You'll have a car accident. Something terrible is going to happen, you know, and you're going to go broke. You're going to lose your home. You know, I mean, all of those things that all of us have going through our heads. And it sure isn't coming from God. If it's fear, if it's anxiety, it's not from God. It's the devil. Amen. It's the enemy lying to you, trying to get you all stressed out. Because how many of you know when you're stressful, you're not good company? One half of each relationship just said, amen. Praise the Lord. I mean it. We have a tendency to speak before we think. We have a tendency to act out of our anxiety and take it out on the nearest person, and usually that's the person that's the closest to us because they're the only ones that will put up with it. Amen? God doesn't want us that way. He wants there to be peace,
right,
amen, in all of our relationships, and especially with Him.
Right.
It's so bizarre how people blame God. They never give God credit, but He's the first one to blame.
Right.
Something went bad. Well, God just killed my neighbor, my friend, you know. God just killed the cat. God just brought a horrible storm, destroyed. It's judgment. It's the judgment of baloney. It's not the judgment of God. The judgment of God's already been poured out on Jesus.
Yeah.
God's not judging. Amen. There will be a great judgment, but we're not going to be part of it. We've already been judged in Jesus and found perfect in Christ. Amen. There's nothing for us to be anxious about. Amen. Other than whatever the next blessing is that God's going to have for us. Amen. How he's going to bless us. Praise the Lord. Did I ever read 2 Corinthians 10? Well, good. What did I say? Praise the Lord. If you hear a hiss, it's probably not a flat tire. It's probably the enemy. And when you hear that hiss of accusation and doubt or fear, when those fiery arrows are flying at you, and that's what you're hearing, the hiss of the arrows. Amen? Accusation, doubt, fear. Here's your protection. Romans 8, verse 31 through 39. And you'll hear it. You heard it on the way to church. You heard it before you got out of the house this morning. And you'll hear it on your way home. Oh, it's nice what he said, but come on. We live in a real world here. Well, let me remind you something. This is nothing but a reflection. This is not the real world. This is just a place. Amen. This is just a place. The real world has been going on for eternity, and it continues to go on. And it's not a billion miles away out in space. It's right here. It's just another dimension. It's just walking in the Spirit. It's looking at things that are not as though they are. We know they're here. We just don't see them with these eyes, but we see them with the heart. There's angels all around us. You know that? This looks like not many people here this morning. More here than there. So if I keep looking over here, it's because I'm pretending it's a full house. But I'm just saying, this place is packed.
Yes.
It's packed with angelic beings.
Yes.
Amen? With the spirits of those who are looking in on what is going on, you know, and want to see and be a part of what they never got to be a part of. Amen?
Yes.
That's real.
Yes.
Just because we don't see it doesn't make it real.
Right.
In fact, the fact that we don't see it makes it more real.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
The things that we see are temporal.
They're
temporary. They just like our own bodies. They only last so long. Amen. Unless the Lord comes back and gives us a glorified body before we die, it's going to go because it's temporary. But the things of God are eternal. The things of the Spirit are eternal. They've always been. They always will be. Amen. That is reality. The reality is what lasts. The reality is what really is. Amen. Enemy. How many times did the enemy come to each one of us over the years of our life and said, you know, man, you really screwed up. This is never going to get fixed. This is always going to be a mess. And you believed it because it looked like it probably would be. And based on our behavior, we thought, well, it's only what I deserve anyhow.
Yeah.
Right? But that's a lie. God wants to give you exceeding abundantly above anything you can imagine. And that's not just dollars and cents, although he wants us to prosper financially. He wants all of our relationships to prosper. He wants everything that we do to prosper. No weapon formed against you can prosper, but everything that God has said must come to pass, as it's already been said here today, because it's just like the rain and the snow that comes down out of heaven. He said it's going to cause whatever on that ground to grow. And he said, if my word comes back to me, that's us preaching to ourselves. If my word comes back to me, how many of you know our real self is Christ in us, the hope of glory? And if that word comes back, he said, it will accomplish whatever I send it to accomplish. So if it's about prosperity, he sends us a word that says, everything you set your hand to is going to prosper. You better get ready for some prosperity. Amen. If he says that by my stripes you were healed, you ought to get ready to start shouting about your healing. Amen. Because God cannot lie. And the enemy is a liar from the very beginning. Everything that comes out of his mouth is a lie. That's why it sounds like the truth. Have you ever known a good liar? I've known some. And you believe them because you think, who could look at me right in the eye and tell me that and not be telling the truth? I mean, they got to be telling the truth. They're so emphatic and they're looking right at me. And I mean, I surely would be able to detect if they... Oh, no. There's some people that really have perfected the art of lying. Amen. Some of them are lawyers. Some of them are used car salesmen. Others are just average people that just have a gift. Praise the Lord, from the enemy. But God is not like a man that he should lie. What comes out of God's mouth is the truth. And if it weren't the truth, it would be the truth as soon as it left his mouth. If God said 5 plus 5 is 11, the moment he said it, it would be 11. It would be. It just would. Because he can't do anything but tell the truth. And his words are truth. Praise the Lord. So what shall we say then to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Now, if God gave everything just for us to be redeemed, why would we think that God wouldn't continue to do anything and everything to give us everything we need in this life? If he gave the most valuable thing, amen? Why then would we think that he wouldn't take care of the other needs? Right? If I came up to you, Roberto, and I handed you a check for $50,000. Here, man. I got it. It's yours because I love you. You know, we're family. Praise the Lord. Would you hesitate to come to me a month or so later and say, Nate, can I borrow $5? I forgot my wallet and I got to pick up a six-pack of Pepsi on the way home. Would you think, you know, I just hate to ask him for that $5. I don't think he could afford it. I don't think he would loan it to me. No, come on, how stupid could you be? Yeah. I just gave you $50,000 for nothing.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
God has given us the riches of heaven in salvation. And we wonder, does he want to heal me?
Yeah.
You know, would God want me to prosper? Give me a break. That's what he's talking about here. If he gave you the thing, then why not all the little things? Why would we question whether he would do those things for us? Amen? He is spared not. So who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? That'd be us. Who's going to say anything about me? Don't you be so. Don't judge me. No, I'm saying the devil is the accuser of the brethren. So he's wanting you to know, when you start hearing accusations, I don't care whose lips it's coming from, the mouth that's speaking is the enemy. It's the spirit of the enemy. Praise the Lord. It is Christ that died. So again, if God is for you, who can be against you? Who cares who condemns? Christ, it's Christ that paid the price for us.
Yeah.
Amen. Yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us.
Yeah.
Amen. Just by his presence, prayed the Lord. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake, we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. In every attack, in every negative circumstance, in every situation that brings anxiety and stress and whatever else it might be to us, we are more than conquerors. We need to remind ourselves, we need to preach to ourselves, we are victors, we are conquerors. No matter what the enemy brings, no matter how bad the battle looks or how poorly we seem to be able to, you know, deal with it, we are conquerors. We are more than conquerors, praise the Lord, through him that loved us. For I'm persuaded, not death, not life, not angels, not principalities, not powers, nor things present, nor things to come. That's pretty much covering everything. Nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Somebody ought to give him a hand clap. Praise the Lord. Now, if you've got something that doesn't fit in there, just imagine that it's supposed to. Praise the Lord. I mean, if you think you can segregate or separate somehow your particular problem that isn't covered in that, you're wrong. It's covered in that. Everything, every situation, every circumstance, nothing is going to be able to separate us from Jesus. Now, let me say this, if I haven't already. He rose and is seated at the right hand of the Father. Amen? God says himself that at his right hand are pleasures forevermore. How? Jesus, our source, our provider, the one who's made us the righteousness of God, the one who restored our relationship, amen, with God so that we can expect, come boldly to God, expecting that God's going to do good things, amen, right? Praise the Lord. It's Christ from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Preach to yourself. Preach to yourself the unlimited love that God has for you. Not for the world, not for the guy next to you, not for somebody down the street who's really spiritual and, you know, really got it all together. For you. In all of your screw-ups and all of your messes and all of your questions and everything else, preach to yourself God's unlimited, unmeasurable, no, not too high, not too deep, not too wide. You can't get to the end of it. Amen? Preach to yourself how much God loves you. How much God wants to do for you. Amen? Romans 8 and 1. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, man's way of doing things, but after the Spirit, God's way of doing things. See, there's no condemnation except when you try to do it your way. Then it's the enemy jumps on you like white on rice, or your own conscience will start messing with you, right? Praise the Lord. And if you think about it, what our own conscience from Adam on is a guilt conscience. It's a guilty conscience. Everybody's got one. And we just do different things to kind of mask it. Right? But he wants us to have a no-sin conscience. A conscience that doesn't even consider sin. When you screw up, just move on. Jesus is forever making intercession. It isn't like he's saying, whoop, there went Leah. Father, let's forgive her. No. You are forgiven eternally. The very presence of Jesus and your faith in him is a constant declaration of your righteousness, your perfection, and your holiness in the eyes of God. Amen. We are in Christ as Christ is in us. So just as Jesus, he says we're seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, right? So God's looking at Jesus. He's seeing Leah. He's seeing Jody. He's seeing John. He's seeing me, right? It's all good because he's perfect. And in him, we are the righteousness of God in Christ. Amen. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus who walk not after the flesh. Please don't let the enemy make you think that that's about, you know, well, he did this or you did that. You were carnal. You got mad and flipped somebody off in traffic or they did you and then you responded with a love word. And anything, whatever, pick a stupid thing that we all do or think and then blame yourself for it. That's what the enemy does, right? That's what he does. So it's not about what we're doing. It's about what we're believing. It's about what we're thinking. Amen? Because if the enemy can get me focused on what I do, every day is a long day. And the night comes around and you're depressed and you're thinking, oh my God, you know, what a jerk. Right? That's not what he's talking about. There's no condemnation to those which are in Christ Jesus who walk by faith. The faith is in what Christ has already done for us. Amen? It's not being, you know, spooky, weird. It's just believing what God said about the circumstance and the situation in spite of what you're seeing. You look at it and you declare what God has said about it. On my refrigerator, I've got stuff all over. Bathroom mirrors, I've got scriptures. Been on there for 5 or 6 years. Sally's grateful because she doesn't have to clean that part of the mirror. Saves her a few minutes in the day. And on the refrigerator, I've got them stuck all over the refrigerator. But that's because I'm preaching to myself. And if I forget to preach to myself, I'll preach to myself through something I've written down based on what the Word of God says. And one of the things I've got on the refrigerator says, you know, faith is looking at defeat and declaring victory. Yeah. It's looking in the face of circumstances that are screaming one thing and you are screaming victory. Yes. That's all faith is. Yeah. It's just looking at things that are not as though they are. It's looking at it the way God looks at it. Yeah. Praise the Lord. And we need to do that every day, all day long. Amen. Yeah. Praise the Lord. That one ought to stay on repeat mode. Yes. Amen. I'd be one that just keeps coming back no matter what. Because the enemy, that's the first thing he always does is, well, you don't deserve to be healed. After all, you're an idiot.
Yeah.
Look what you did. Yeah. You don't deserve a financial breakthrough because you made such a stupid decision the last time you had a few bucks.
Right.
You know? So, you know, that's what the enemy does.
Yep.
You're not a good steward. So you have no right to have anything of any quality or value. That is bogus. You are a child of God Almighty, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Listen, if anybody deserves to have some stuff, you do.
Yes.
If anybody deserves to have peace, if anybody deserves to have a sense of purpose, it's us.
Yes.
Amen? Glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Okay. Did anybody here read labels? I mean, when you go shopping, do you actually look and see what it is you're buying? I always do for the dog. Dog food. I rarely do for me because I figure, well, that's what they make hot sauce for. Praise the Lord. But anyhow, you know, if you do read them, it'll freak you out because I know there's a lot of stuff about lactose intolerance. And I'm, you know, I just can't stand lactose. So I'm totally lactose intolerant. And I'm trying to get past it, but it's a personal issue. Okay, now I'm serious because you didn't really get what I was saying anyhow. Praise the Lord. But there's all kinds of gluten-free stuff, right? Now, I don't have any trouble. I'm not a glutton, so I don't worry about the gluten-free gluten-free aisle. No, gluten. So, I'm not. I don't have a problem with gluten. I use it on everything, praise the Lord. Whatever it is, I just have it. Hallelujah. But there's these labels all the time that say gluten-free products. But gluten-free doesn't mean zero gluten present. Okay? Just because it says gluten-free doesn't mean there is zero gluten in that item. Because the FDA says, see, I've done my research. The FDA says food can be classified gluten-free as long as it contains less than 22 parts per million of gluten. And you think, well, that's nothing. 22 parts per million? That's a small amount. It's the lowest amount that can be detected with today's technology. Whatever gluten technology there is out there, that's how far it goes. That's not quite pure purity. And that not quite pure purity standard may work for the world, but not in the kingdom of God. Amen? The good news of the gospel is that not even a trace, nothing, zip, zero, nada, not a trace of condemnation exists towards you. None. Read the label, praise the Lord. Condemnation free. 100%, none in there, hallelujah. There's none on you, there's none in you. Don't settle for the FDA standards. Don't settle for this world standards. God has done it perfectly. He has declared you righteous, pure, holy, accepted in the beloved. Amen. A child. Amen. An heir. A joint heir with Jesus. Amen. Give gluten a hand. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Your identity is in Christ. Condemnation free. Can you find anything to condemn Jesus? Even Pilate couldn't condemn him. He wasn't even a believer. And he said, I find no fault in this man. Amen? Hallelujah. Condemnation free in Christ, declared by God. And God, believe me, can detect the minutest impurity in anything and everything. We're talking about the master inspector, if you will. He's got the technology down to, I can find a speck, if there is one. And he says, no speck. Perfect. Holy. Pure. Child of God. Man, you need to preach that to yourself. You need to talk to yourself. You need to quit listening to yourself, and you need to start talking to yourself. Amen? Take authority. Renew your mind to your true identity, to who you really are. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You are fully forgiven, completely loved, absolutely righteous, and totally justified. Amen?
Amen.
That's you. Now, if God is for you, who can be against you? What's he going to do to somebody like Jesus? Who are they going to call? Ghostbusters. We got the Holy Ghost. Hey, you ain't busting that. That ain't going to happen. Praise the Lord. He's in charge. Surf's up. Praise the Lord. I don't know what happened to me. I've just got caught in a midlife crisis here right before your very eyes. Hallelujah. I'm an old man just wishing. Hallelujah. Come on, Jesus. Keep me young. Hallelujah. My like the wings of eagles. Glory to God. Amen. God loves you so much. He wants to give you the desires of your heart. He does. That's not just verbiage. That's just not a nice thing to say. That's what God said. Exceeding abundantly your desires. Because your desires are still pretty small compared to what God really wants to do. Hallelujah. Jesus wants you liberated. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. He wants you free from legalism. Free of fear of failure. You know, we ought to be the most courageous people. No matter what it is. No matter what it's about. We shouldn't have no fear. If God's for me, who's against me? And whoever they are, who cares?
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen? God is on my side.
Right.
All right, Psalms 34, verse 15, Sheila. You know, David... The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open unto their cry. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are listening for you. Amen? You don't have to pull off a superhero feat, spiritually or otherwise, to earn God's help. God's care. In reality, he's already helping. He's already done it. Amen? The truth is, God is constantly interested and not only interested in you, but invested in you. Think about it. He made a big investment. He gave his life. God in the flesh, Son, Jesus. He gave that life for you. He's invested all the way. I mean, he put everything into this. He just pushed it all out on the table and said, there, we're rolling for the whole. We're going for all of it. Doubling down and coming out with the bankroll. Hallelujah. Amen. He's for us. He's with us. He's determined to bless us. Praise God. We tend to think that God is going to treat us the way we treat him. Anybody ever had a day where you just really weren't that buddies with God? You know, I mean, you know, I know we believe all the time, but there are some days when we just think, oh, God, are you going to do anything about this? Or what is this all about? You know, what's going on? And so we kind of just ignore it. Or the devil beats us up with condemnation because we've done something else that's really stupid, and so we just kind of, you know, we don't want to have to deal with it right now. We don't want to talk to God because we're feeling guilty and ashamed and blah, 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 blah. And we tend to think that God then is going to treat us the same way we treat him. Let me tell you this morning that you could not be more wrong if you tried. Amen? 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 13. Praise the name of God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Study to show yourself approved. No, that's not it. It's a good one, but it's not the one. Praise the Lord. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful, he cannot deny himself. Praise God. That's the wonder of grace. That's the miracle of God, if you will. And that's what you need to preach to yourself. Even when you're not faithful. Even when you make a conscious decision to do something that you know you shouldn't do. He abides faithful. Amen? Because he can't be anything else. Amen? He can't deny himself. That's his reality. That's who he is. That's what he is. That's what he's declared about us. We are his. Amen? Praise the Lord. Grace fits every occasion. There isn't some situation or circumstance that grace doesn't work for. He said, my grace is sufficient. There's no occasion, amen, where grace doesn't fit. Christ cares about everything in our lives. Everything. Every detail, every situation. And I want to say this to you, and I'm prophesying right now. And I'm prophesying based on the Word of God, so I know it's a fact. I know that God's going to back it up. Amen? God's going to do something incredible for you. He's going to do something incredible for you. You just need to start preaching it to yourself. Man, it's going to get better tomorrow. Amen? God's got something in the works. God's going to do something incredible on my behalf. I don't care how long you've been waiting. I don't care how long you've been fussing with yourself and listening to yourself and listening to the enemy. It's time you start talking to yourself. It's time you start preaching to yourself. And it's time you start saying what God says about it. Amen. And then have an expectation of good because he wants to give you the desires of your heart. Amen. And only he can really do it. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. God's promises are engineered, amen, to lift us up. Not just in our spirit, but in our soul, in our way of thinking, in our way of dealing with stuff. That's what the promises are for. He gave us these precious promises, amen, amen, and so that we would know that our divine, we have received his divine nature. Amen? So how do we adjust then? Well, then we take this divine nature, this nature of God, and we start functioning from that. We start claiming those promises that are already ours, amen, and watch them begin to manifest. Praise the Lord. Everybody in here, do you believe that all things are possible with God? I mean, do we really believe that, or do we just say it because it's in the Bible? Nothing is impossible for God. I'll give you all these things if you'll just do it my way. If you'll just say what I say. If you'll just talk to yourself and quit listening to yourself. Amen. I will give you the desires of your heart. Praise God. Hallelujah. So I just suggest this morning that you hold on not only to the promises, but hold on to the promiser. Yes. And believe what is to come. This. Whatever it is in your particular situation. Nothing's too big for God. Romans 8:18. Hallelujah, Jesus. And I know some of you are thinking, well, if you can believe for anything, why don't you believe for perfect eyesight? Well, there's nothing wrong with my eyes. I wear these for dramatic effect. I only need them to see. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Now, that word sufferings there is just really trials, problems. So the problems of this present time are nothing compared to the glory which is going to be revealed in us. And that's not just in heaven. That's right here.
Yes.
How is God glorified? By His grace.
Yes.
Because it's free gifting from God. He's not glorified by stuff that I do that earns something. He's glorified by His goodness and His grace that's just poured out on us.
Yes.
And all of eternity, God is going to be glorified.
Yes.
Amen? Because of His great grace. Hallelujah. You know, the devil hates grace. He hates it because it takes him out of the equation, just like it takes us out of the equation.
Right.
And it puts the whole thing in God's hands,
right,
in whom He has no part. The devil can't get to Him. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Amen. So go back to the gospel again and quit listening to yourself. Start preaching to yourself. Start talking to yourself. Every time, amen, you get an anxious feeling or thought or someone says something, man, just start preaching.
Yes.
Just start talking to yourself.
Right.
Amen? You know what they say about real estate? You know, everything is location, 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 right? Well, when it comes to the real estate of joy and contentment and peace and fulfillment, it's all about location, location, location. Amen? Only in God's presence. Amen? Only beholding Jesus at the right hand, victorious. Amen? Peace will come. Amen. Joy will come.
Amen.
Courage will come.
Yes.
Expectation of good will come. Location, location, location. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You get in the right place in Jesus, you don't need foot traffic. You know, I mean, that's like sales. You get a store, you want location. You want a lot of foot traffic. You want people, you don't want to just, people got to drive there to get there because they don't, you know, we're lazy. There's too many of those between here and there. But you want people that are just out walking. That's why you go to the store and they have all these little weird items at the checkout counter. It's location. Because you're standing there waiting for somebody, you know, to figure out how much money they got and pay their bill. And while you're there, you're watching, you're looking at Tom Cruise is actually an alien. I didn't know it, but hey, it's worth looking into. I've been to some of those movies. They're freaking me out, you know. So I'm just saying, hey, I know what I'm talking about. I used to work for a company called Novelty. And I went all over the state. And you ever go on Quick Trips and Get and Goes, and you see all those little weird things on that display there by the counter, you think, who buys this stuff? Believe me. Everybody buys it if they've got a kid that's under 10 years of age, because it's the only way you can shut them up and get out of the store. They got their arms full of stuff, you know. It's all junk. But hey, I made a living. Praise the Lord. I made a living doing it. Hallelujah. Now, I won't go into it because I've already embarrassed all of you with the farting Santas and burping witches and everything else. Yes, I actually did that. I wasn't proud of it, but hey, it was an honest living. And I'm saying location, location. You put those back, you know, by the yeast. They'll be there for 20 years.
Yeah.
But put them up there next to the counter with the candy and the sodas. And I mean, everybody's grabbing stuff. Just, hey, that's kind of cute. I think I'll give it to a grandson. Of course, who knew, you know, that it was going to be some demon thing. But praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Location, location, location. Praise the Lord. Psalm 16 and 11. Hallelujah. Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand are pleasures forevermore. Think about this. We can't ever go anywhere that He isn't with us. Praise the Lord. In His presence, there's fullness of joy. We need to keep reminding ourselves, I'm in His presence. Amen. I am in His presence. I'm seated with Him in heavenly places at His right hand. Pleasures forevermore. Have every right to expect good things, pleasurable things, blessings. Amen? Not just for me, for mine. Praise the Lord. The Bible is not a book of rules, in spite of what most of us have been taught. It's not a bunch of things to be memorized. The Bible is a story. It's an adventure. And it's about a hero who comes from a far country to take back his lost treasure. Best thing about the story is, it's true. It's not a make-believe. It's not a fairy tale. It's a reality. Preach it to yourself. Talk to yourself about it. You know, there's lots of stories in the Bible, but all of the stories are telling one big story. No matter what story you're reading, it's really talking about a big reality, a bigger story. Amen? The story of how God loves his children, and he comes to rescue them.
Yeah.
It's that simple, really.
Yeah.
It takes a whole Bible to tell this story. And at the center of the story, there's a baby. Every story in the Bible whispers this baby's name. I don't go all the way back to Genesis. There's always this kind of a little sound that's going on there that you don't see directly connected, but yet it's whispering. It's telling us something about Jesus. Everything in there. He's like the missing piece of the puzzle. The piece that makes all the other pieces fit together.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, Peter's son loves Legos. You know, there's always that, unless you get that one piece, it doesn't look right. I mean, it just doesn't fit. It just doesn't work, right? I was never very good with Legos or mechanical stuff of any kind to speak of, but puzzles, you figure them out. Jesus is that missing puzzle piece that makes the puzzle come together, that shows you what the real picture God's trying to paint for us here. It's the real purpose of the story. It isn't all those other things. It's Jesus. He makes the pieces fit. And like all good stories, the bad guy gets vanquished. The good prevails. The bad guy gets a punch in the nose and he's locked up and it's good. Amen. It's time that we believed it, church. Because if you don't believe it, you don't get the happily ever after. Right? We're supposed to be living happily ever after. You've got to know how the story goes to get the happily ever after.
Yeah.
We should, of all people, ought to be happy.
Yeah.
We ought to be happily ever aftering right now. We don't have to wait to heaven. We're already in eternal life. The moment we got born again, we're already in the happy ever after.
Yeah.
Amen. We just haven't seen the totality of it.
Right.
Amen.
Yeah.
You believe it?
Yes.
Declare it. And start with yourself.
Yes.
Tell it to yourself. Go back to the gospel again. Not for salvation, not for conversion, but for confidence in Jesus.
Yeah.
Amen? While you were yet sinners, he died for you. If he would do that, while you were still a sinner, is there anything that he would withhold from you now that you're a believer, now that you're a child?
No.
Amen? Stop listening to yourself and start talking to yourself. Praise the Lord. Let me wrap it up with these two last scriptures. Romans 8:31. Actually, it's more than two. It's a three or four. What shall we then say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Amen? All right, let's drop down to verses 37 through 39, and then I will really honestly stop. Nay, in all these things, whatever they are, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. I'm persuaded, death, life, angels, principalities, powers, things present, things to come, height, depth, any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Give him a hand clap this morning. Praise God. Amen, amen, amen. God is challenging you. Amen. Just pull down every stronghold, every high thought that tries to exalt itself above the Word of God. Preach to it. Amen. Get anointed. Get the ointment on you. Hallelujah. And just let it fly. Praise the Lord. Just let her flow. Glory to God. Amen. Just let the enemy know you know who you are and he can't deceive you. Praise the Lord. And expect something stupendous or stupendous, depending on the part of the country you're from. And God's going to fulfill it. Amen?
Yes.
He's not limited to my vocabulary either, by the way, so you can relax. Hallelujah. He wants to do something spectacular for you. He wants to do something magnificent. All he's asking is that you will agree with him and shut that devil's mouth and open yours. Amen. God bless you. Go in the power of his Spirit. You are blessed in Jesus' name. Have a great week. See you back here Wednesday if you can make it. God bless you. Keep talking. Hallelujah.